Hello everyone there. So welcome back to Jyotsna's Colorful Chemistry. So in today's class, let us take a look of the physical properties of aldehydes and ketones. So now, coming to the physical properties, the first physical property we are going to study is about the boiling point. Now, coming to the boiling point, it is seen that the boiling point of this aldehydes, that is RCHO, and that of ketones, that is RCOR dash. This is higher than that of corresponding hydrocarbon and ethers of similar molecular mass. So hydrocarbons and ether have lesser boiling point compared to that of aldehydes and ketones, whose molecular mass is almost similar. And this is because there is dipole-dipole interaction in the aldehydes and ketones due to the presence of the carbonyl group. In the same way, the boiling point of this aldehydes and ketones is lesser than the corresponding alcohols. So let us take ROH, where R is an alkyl group. So R is alkyl. So then only it will form the alcohols. So compared to the similar molecular mass alcohols, the boiling point of aldehydes and ketones is lesser than that of the alcohols. Now why it is lesser than alcohols is, in alcohols there is intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Because of that, the molecular mass, the boiling point of this one is greater compared to that of the boiling point of the aldehydes and ketones. So this is about the first property, that is about the boiling point. Then next to that one, we have the next property, that is the solubility. Now in solubility, the lower members of the aldehydes and ketones, such as methanol, ethanol, propanone, etc., are soluble in water in all proportions because they are forming the hydrogen bonding with water. So because of this reason, the lower members are going to dissolve in water. But when it comes to the solubility of the compounds, aldehydes and ketones, the higher members are hardly soluble in the water. So there is rapid decrease in the solubility of these compound with the increase in the length of the alkyl chain. Most of them or all of them are soluble in organic solvents like that of benzene, ether and chloroform. Also, it is seen that the lower members have pungent odor, that is they have the irritating smell. But as the size of the molecule increases, the odor becomes more pleasant or more fragrant and less pungent. And many naturally occurring aldehydes and ketones are used in perfumes, in flavoring agents, etc. So for example, we can take vanillin. I hope most of you are aware of vanillin. So the essence, that is the vanilla essence which you use or you have tasted the ice creams or the milkshake. So that vanilla has been extracted from the vanilla beans, which is called as the vanillin. So this is coming under the aldehydes and the ketones. So therefore, such of the compounds are being used in the perfume industries and in the flavoring agent. The other examples are salicylaldehyde and cinnamaldehyde, etc. I think you have taken the smell of iodex. So that we call it as the smell of wintergreen. The component in that one is nothing but methyl salicylate, or it is a derivative of salicylaldehyde. So these compounds are going to give the various odors, pleasant odors. So next to that one, we are going to study about the chemical properties of aldehydes and ketones. Now, Coming to the chemical properties of aldehydes and ketones, because aldehydes and ketones both have the carbonyl group, that is the CO group, because of that reason, both of them undergo similar type of the chemical properties. So now let us take a look of what are the chemical properties undergone by both the aldehydes and ketone. In general, we call them as the carbonyl compounds. The first type of the reaction which the carbonyl compounds undergo is the nucleophilic addition reaction. Now, coming to the addition reaction, this is the reaction which is characteristic reaction of the double bond and the triple bond. Since there is presence of a double bond between carbon and oxygen, easily it is undergoing addition reaction. But why is it undergoing nucleophilic addition reaction? Just let us take a look. Now suppose if I take the carbonyl compound, that is carbon to oxygen, there is a bond. So when you compare the electronegativity, oxygen will acquire partial negative charge, carbon will acquire partial positive charge. So when a nucleophile comes in contact, so that is having a negative charge, or let us consider electron rich species, so naturally it will get attracted towards the positively charged species. Therefore, this nucleophile is going to attack the carbon. It is going to break this bond, and this nucleophile is going to add to this one. And therefore, we are seeing the nucleophilic addition reaction in this case. So in this nucleophilic addition reaction, there is one mechanism. So how this nucleophile is going to add? In this mechanism, a nucleophile is going to attack the electrophilic carbon, and this nucleophile will be in a direction which is perpendicular to the plane of sp2 hybridized carbon, that is the carbonyl carbon. So during this hybridization of the carbon, changes from sp2 to sp3 and a tetrahedral alkoxide intermediate is formed. The intermediate obtained is capturing a proton from the reaction mixture to give electrically neutral product, and hence the net result is addition of the nucleophile and the H+. So what does this mean? Let us take a look of this one. So coming to the mechanism of this nucleophilic addition reaction. As you know that the carbon to oxygen, whatever we have seen, this bond is no doubt a covalent bond here, and it is a polar covalent bond. And carbon is having sp2 type of the hybridization. Here the carbon which is involved is sp2 hybridized carbon. So there will be one substituent here, B, and let us take a substituent A. So this entire thing is going to be in one plane. So let me consider like this carbon and the double bonded oxygen, and these two species all are in one plane. Suppose if you are going to place this entire thing on a table, consider that there is a table. So on this table, what we are going to do, we are going to place this molecule. So carbon is connected to oxygen in this direction, and carbon is connected to A, let me say it is away from the observer. So what we are going to do, we are going to show it in a dotted line. So this is away from the observer, and one more species is towards the observer, which we are going to show it by means of a bold line. So this is towards the observer. So entire thing is in one particular plane. Let us consider on table we have placed this molecule. So one towards this side, one away from us, one towards us. So this is entirely on the table. Now a nucleophile is going to come. How it comes is, it is going to come like this, which is perpendicular to the plane. So in this way it is going to come. So this nucleophile is above, this is our table. So this nucleophile is exactly perpendicular to that of this molecule. So now what is going to happen? This nucleophile is going to attack the carbon in a direction which is perpendicular to this plane. So this nucleophile, what will happen? It is going to attack the carbon. This step is a slow step. So you can see that nucleophile attacks the carbon, and this step is a slow step. As you know that carbon here is sp2 hybridized carbon. Once the nucleophile attacks this one, the hybridization of this carbon changes from sp2 to sp3. So this is a planar molecule because it is sp2 hybridized. Now it is undergoing the change in the hybridization. It changes to sp3. So once it comes to sp3, it is nothing but tetrahedral structure. And here what is going to happen? In this tetrahedral intermediate, it is forming an alkoxide. So we call this as an alkoxide ion. So this is an intermediate which is obtained. But this is unstable. Therefore, it is going to capture the H plus ion which is present in the reaction mixture. So this is going to capture the H plus ion, and it leads to the formation of the addition product, that is nothing but OH here is added. So overall what we have done, first we have introduced the Nu minus and then we have introduced the H plus. So this is the overall mechanism which is undergone by the aldehydes or the ketones. So this is about the mechanism. So next to this mechanism, we have the reasons about the reactivity about the aldehydes and ketones, which is reacting more and why. So here, coming to the aldehydes are more reactive than ketones. Now, why are aldehydes more reactive than ketones? This is because there is presence of two bulky substituent groups in the ketone, which hinder the approach of nucleophile to the carbonyl carbon, than in aldehyde, which is having only one substituent. So what does this mean? Now, in case of, let me take an example. Suppose if I take here a ketone, C double bond O, here one R and here one R dash. I will replace this R, let me say, by C2H5. And here there is one carbon, oxygen, this is C2H5. Now what has happened? This C2H5 is occupying certain space. This C2H5 is occupying certain space. So, attack of this nucleophile on this compound is restricted because there is certain steric hindrance. So, the nucleophile has to break this barrier and attack the carbon of the ketone. So, it is a little bit difficult. But, whereas in case of aldehyde, that is R, C, O and H. Now, what has happened? There is a bulkier group over here. This is a small atom. So suppose I take C2H5 and C double bond O, and this is H. So this is a small atom and this is a larger species. Now if nucleophile has to attack this one, so it is easy because there is no much steric hindrance between these two, because this is a large species, this is a smaller ones. So there is enough space for the nucleophile to attack. Therefore, this nucleophilic attack is more easier in aldehyde compared to that of the ketone. So here you can see that the nucleophile can attack the carbon of the aldehyde because there is no much steric hindrance here. Why? Because this is a larger species, this is a smaller species. So nucleophile can easily attack because there is space. In this case, what has happened? This is a larger species, this is larger species. These are coming closer to each other. There is certain steric hindrance and nucleophile cannot reach this carbon easily. Therefore, no doubt it attacks, but reactivity of aldehyde is more easier compared to that of the reactivity of the ketone, the nucleophilic attack. So therefore, the aldehydes react more easily than that of the ketone. Then, next to that one, we have one more, that is benzaldehyde is less reactive towards the nucleophilic addition reaction than alkanols. Means this is an aromatic aldehyde. Compared to the aliphatic aldehyde, benzaldehyde is less reactive. Why? Because the carbon atom of the carbonyl group of benzaldehyde is less electrophilic than the carbon atom of the carbonyl group in alkenol. So the carbon involved is what? It is less electrophilic. Along with that, the polarity of the carbonyl compound is carbonyl group is reduced in benzaldehyde due to resonance. So because of the resonance, what happens? It is going to reduce the polarity. Therefore, because of these two reasons, benzaldehyde is less reactive compared to that of what? Compared to that of the alkenols. So this is about the reactivity. So further, we are going to make use of the mechanism what we have seen earlier, and we are going to look for the addition of the hydrogen cyanide to aldehyde and ketone by making use of this mechanism. So this part we shall take it in the next class.